บ่าสมชื่นกุยអង្គជំនុំជម្រះតុលាការកំពូលប្រកាសបន្តសវនាការលោកឡានជីតើភិក្ខុនិងមេធាវីចូលគ្រប់ចំនួនហើយឬនៅ
បាទជម្រាបប្រសាសន៍ឯកឧត្តមប្រធាននៅថ្ងៃនេះគឺភិក្ខុចូលគ្រប់ចំនួនក៏ប៉ុន្តែនៅអវត្តមានខាងមេធាវីដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋពលីគឺមានលោកករីមខាន់អវត្តមានលោកលោកស្រីមុចសវណ្ណរីអវត្តមាននិងលោកមេធាវីកឹមម៉េងខីអវត្តមានបាទ
មុននឹងចាប់ផ្ដើមចូលដល់វគ្គទី2នេះគឺខ្ញុំសូមជម្រាបទៅដល់ភិក្ខុហើយនឹងមេធាវីបានជ្រាបថាការថ្លែងរបស់អស់លោកគឺសូមឲ្យយឺតយឺតដើម្បីសម្រួលដល់កិច្ចការបកប្រែរបស់អ្នកបកប្រែផងជាបន្តទៅនេះគឺសូមអញ្ជើញចៅក្រមរបាយការណ៍អានរបាយការណ៍ស្ដីពីអង្គរដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងនឹងមនុស្សជាតិសូមអញ្ជើញ
Thank you, Mr. President. The second ground of the co-prosecutor's appeal is that the trial judgment erred in law by subsuming specific crimes against humanity under the crime of persecution on political grounds. The co-prosecutors submit that the accused should have been convicted cumulatively for all the acts constituting crimes against humanity for which he was found responsible. Let us recall.That the trial judgment found the accused individually criminally responsible for the following offenses as crimes against humanity: murder, extermination, enslavement, imprisonment, torture, and this including one instance of rape, and persecution on political grounds and other inhumane acts. The trial chamber convicted the accused of persecution on political grounds and held that other crimes against humanity are subsumed under this conviction. In short,As the matter will be expertly argued before us, we recall that co-prosecutors submit that the trial chamber erred by subsuming other, under persecution on political grounds, the other crimes against humanity for which the accused was found responsible. The prosecutors argued that each crime against humanity for which the accused was found responsible has a materially distinct element not found in the others. The trial chamber's failure to convict the accused of all the crimes against humanity for which he was found responsible undermines the twin aims of cumulative convictions, as it does not fully reflect the accused's individual criminal responsibility or the actual extent of his involvement in the commission.They further submit that any rationale for not allowing cumulative convictions discussed in the international jurisprudence does not apply in this case. Specifically, in the prosecutor's view, the accused is not eligible for parole.And the likelihood that the accused will leave Cambodia for another jurisdiction, much less be convicted in another jurisdiction, is effectively non-existent. Further, the trial chamber failed to fully consider the societal interests protected by each enumerated crime, and that more complete description of the accused criminal conduct was needed.For the sake of posterity and the court's historical record. The co-prosecutors further submit that the trial chamber erred in law by subsuming the crime against humanity of rape under the crime against humanity of torture and by characterizing the single instance of rape as a component of torture.
ការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈនោះគឺជាប្រភេទនៃការធ្វើទារុណកម្ម
The co-prosecutors would request that the Supreme Court chamber convict the accused of the discrete crime against humanity
ជនជាប់ចោទចំពោះបទរំលោភនៅក្នុងក
ិច្ចការកម្មាធិការ
មិនមានសេចក្តីសន្និដ្ឋានតប
ដាក់ជូន
ចំពោះបណ្ដឹងសារទុក
របស់ថាព្រះញ្ញោទេចំពោះបណ្ដឹងសារទុកនេះដ
ល់ការកំពូលសូមលើកឡើងអំពីការកាត់ទោស
ជាច្រើនបទចោទជាពិសេស
ការលើកឡើងរបស់ថាព្រះញ្ញោដោយផ្អែកទៅលើនិយមន័យ
នៃច្បាប់ព្រហ្មទណ្ឌដូច្នេះហើយបណ្ដឹងសារទុកនេះthat the chamber examined the appropriateness of the criminal definitions employed for this test. Examining those definitions is necessary to ascertain the jurisdiction of this court and ultimately for deciding if the chamber were to enter any of the convictions sought by the appeal.
Accordingly,
the chamber provided for the parties for an opportunity to comment on the relevant legal notions of crimes against humanity, persecution, rape, and enslavement.
ការធ្វើទុកបុកម្នេញការដាក់ជាទាសករនិងការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈ
តឡៃកទី3នៃបណ្ដឹងសារទុករបស់សហព្រះញ្ញាលើកឡើងថាអង្គជំនុំព្រះសាលាដំបូងមានកំហុសឆ្គងផ្នែកច្បាប់ដោយកំណត់និយមន័យពុំបានត្រឹមត្រូវលើពាក្យការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករហើយជាលទ្ធផលអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងខកខានមិនបានផ្ដន់ទាទោសជនជាប់ចោទពីបទធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករនៃអ្នកទោសទាំងអស់នៅមន្ទីរស-21ឡើយពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងបទចោទប្រកាន់ស្ដីពីការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករក្នុងសំណុំរឿងលេខ001អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងគាត់សម្គាល់ឃើញថាតាមដីកាដំណោះស្រាយការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករមានអត្ថន័យដូចខាងក្រោមអ្នកទោសមួយចំនួននៃមន្ទីរស-21និងព្រឹកទីស-24ត្រូវបានគេបង្ខំឲ្យធ្វើការគ្រប់ធិដ្ឋភាពនៃការរស់នៅរបស់ពួកគេត្រូវបានយាមកាមយ៉ាងតឹងរ៉ឹងតាមរយៈការកម្រិតលើការដើរហើរនិងកន្លែងរស់នៅការចាត់វិធានការទប់ស្កាត់និងរារាំងក្នុងការរត់គេចខ្លួននិងធ្វើឲ្យពួកគេទទួលបាននូវការធ្វើបាបនិងការបំពានយ៉ាងខុសខើដោយសារអំពើទាំងនេះអ្នកទោសត្រូវបានគេដកហូតនៅសិទ្ធិសេរីភាពអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងយល់ឃើញថាឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងនឹងមនុស្សជាតិនៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាស្គរត្រូវបានកំណត់ជាចរិតលក្ខណៈតាមរយៈការនិប្រើអំណាចមួយឬក៏ទាំងអស់ចរិយក្នុងនាមជាម្ចាស់កម្មសិទ្ធិលើបុគ្គលណាម្នាក់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងរាប់បញ្ចូលការធ្វើពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំជាសញ្ញាមួយនៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាស្គរហើយក៏បានបញ្ជាក់ផងដែរថាការធ្វើពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំឬដោយគ្មានការស្ម័គ្រចិត្តអាចបង្កើតជាធាតុផ្សំនៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅទាសករអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងយល់ឃើញថាបុគ្គលិកមន្ទីរស-21បានអនុវត្តអំណាចដោយចេតនានិងគ្រប់គ្រងទាំងស្រុងលើអ្នកទោសនៅស-24និងអ្នកទោសមួយចំនួនតូចនៅក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21ដែលត្រូវបានចាត់តាំងធ្វើឲ្យការឲ្យក្នុងបរិវេណមន្ទីរស-21នោះអ្នកទោសទាំងនេះមិនមានសិទ្ធិសេរីភាពបដិសេធមិនធ្វើការងារដែលគេចាត់តាំងឲ្យពួកគេនោះឡើយហើយមិនបានយល់ព្រមជាមួយនឹងលក្ខខណ្ឌនៃការឃុំខ្លួនរបស់ពួកគេដែរហើយដូច្នេះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងយល់ឃើញថាការធ្វើពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំឬដោយគ្មានការស្ម័គ្រចិត្តដែលបុករួមជាមួយនឹងការឃុំខ្លួនរបស់ពួកគេបង្កើតបានទៅជាទាសករសហព្រះញ្ញាលើកឡើងថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងមានកំហុសឆ្គងផ្នែកច្បាប់ដោយកំណត់ធ្វើពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំឬការគ្មានការស្ម័គ្រចិត្តជាធាតផ្សំចាំបាច់នៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករជាជាងសញ្ញានៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករសហព្រះរាជអាជ្ញាលើកឡើងថាដោយសារតែការកំណត់និយមន័យនៃពាក្យធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករមិនបានត្រឹមត្រូវអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងខកខានមិនបានផ្ដន់ទាទោសជនជាប់ចោទស្ដីពីការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករនៅក្រុមអ្នកទោសដ៏ធំឬគឺអ្នកទោសទាំងអស់នៅក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21ដោយគ្មានគិតដល់ពួកគាត់ត្រូវបានទទួលរងការធ្វើពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំឬដោយគ្មានការស្ម័គ្រចិត្តនោះឡើយយោងតាមសហព្រះរាជអាជ្ញាសាលក្រមសាលាដំបងបង្ហាញនៅសំអាងហេតុយ៉ាងគ្រប់គ្រាន់ថាអំណាចនានាដែលភ្ជាប់ទៅនឹងសិទ្ធិនៃកម្មសិទ្ធិត្រូវបានអនុវត្តនៅក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21ដែលបំពេញនៅលក្ខខណ្ឌនិងនិយមន័យនៃការនៃពាក្យការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករដែលជាឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងនឹងមនុស្សជាតិ បន្ថែមលើនេះអំពើទាំងនេះត្រូវបានប្រព្រឹត្តឡើងដោយចេតនានិងក្នុងគោលបំណងអនុវត្តនូវកម្មសិទ្ធិលើអ្នកទោសហើយដូច្នេះសហព្រះរាជអាជ្ញាស្នើសុំថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះតុលាការកំពូលផ្ដន់ទោសជនជាប់ចោទពីបទឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងនឹងមនុស្សជាតិនៃការធ្វើឲ្យទៅជាទាសករពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងអ្នកទោសទាំងអស់នៅក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21ដោយពុំចាប់បាច់ពិចារណាថាពួកគាត់ត្រូវបានទទួលរងការបង្ខំដោយពលកម្មឬដោយគ្មានការស្ម័គ្រចិត្តនោះឡើយគ្មានចម្លើយតបជាលេខលះអសរត្រូវបានធ្វើឡើងតបទៅនឹងបណ្ដឹងរបស់សាតុព្រះរាជញ្ញាឡើយសូមអរគុណ
សូមអញ្ជើញសហព្រះរាជញ្ញាធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងតទៅនឹងសារណាបណ្ដឹងសាតុមក
May it please the court. Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. In the space of 45 minutes, I'm going to attempt to address the issues that have been raised. They are substantial issues, and I'm going to have to abbreviate in order to get through all of theissues which were discussed by the rapporteurs. The first issue that I will deal with is the issue of cumulative charging for crimes against humanity. By this question that has been put to the co-prosecutors, I'm not going to simply repeat paragraphs 134 to 191 of our submission, but I would ask you to consider that when you are determining this issue. What I aim to do is to provide you with the current legal basis for cumulative charging, and then to very briefly discuss with you any effect on sentencing. Our argument, put quite simply, is this. The trial chamber's interpretation of the law in its judgment in respect of cumulative convictions was wrong. The misapplication of that law can be found in paragraph 565 of the trial judgment. The trial chamber, in essence, decided to ignoreThe majority judgment in the 2004 Yugoslav Tribunal Appeals Judgment of Kordic, and that is 71 in our table of authorities within our appeal. While this chamber, and indeed the trial chamber, is and was not bound by international jurisprudence,The majority judgment in that case is in my submission, Your Honours, where the guidance lies on this issue. For the sake of consistency and indeed legality, it is my submission that the trial chamber should have followed the majority judgment in that case. This court, whilst a domestic court, has many features of an international court.It will hear very few cases, and the likelihood is that legal scholars, other courts dealing with these very serious offences, will look to this institution now and in the future to find guidance on the interpretation of both substantive and procedural issues in respect of international criminal law.It is my submission that there is an obligation, respectfully, that we create a consistent body of law. Before examining the Kordic case, let me very simply state what the concept of cumulative convictions means. It means, as Judge Milan said, convicting an individual of more than one criminal offence.Upon the basis of the same conduct. Why are individuals convicted of different charges for the same conduct? Well, for the two legal policy factors that Judge Milat mentioned, that multiple convictions protect and recognize different interests, and more importantly, most importantly here, particularly for this court, there is a proper historical record of convictions to fully describe what the respondent did. These two matters are indeed law, and we cite them in our brief, and you will find them cited in international case law. I won't go through all of that case law, but you will find these principles discussed at paragraph 347 of the appeals judgment in the Musima case. That's authority number 90 in our table of authorities. Also in the Akyesu case, that's A-K-A-Y-E-S-U, that's number 84 in our table of authorities, and that's paragraph
468.
Just as a side note, let me put this in perspective for you. The Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal will have charged 160 individuals by the time it finishes its work. So that court's record is fulsome in providing a proper, accurate, historical record of what actually took place and for which crimes people were charged and either convicted or acquitted. The many human interests that were ruptured in that war in Yugoslavia have been recognized in the charges laid at the feet of the accused. Let me put this in perspective in this case. The trial judgment has found that this man, who presided over mass executions of adults and children through indescribably brutal methods, beaten and stabbed to death, blood drawn from living bodies, a prison population enslaved, conditions of detention hitherto unrepeated since the Second World War. Words barely serve their suffering and misery. Fellow human beings robbed of due process, tortured, beaten. The murder and extermination of no fewer than 12,272 living souls. And as we stand today, there will be a single conviction in this case for the crime against humanity of persecution. This does not recognize all of the interests that were ruptured by this man's acts, nor does it serve austerity, truth or reconciliation as a proper record of what happened. What does it say to the future generations of this country about what this man did and mostly to his own people? I would ask you respectfully to have these factors at the forefront of your mind when you are determining this issue. Now let me move to the legal test. The legal test is laid down in a decision commonly called the Celibici decision, also known as the Prosecutor and Mucic. It's a Yugoslav tribunal decision. It's number 83 in our table of authorities. Multiple criminal convictions entered under different statutory provisions but based on the same conduct are permissible only if each statutory provision involved has a materially distinct element not contained in the other. An element is materially distinct from another if it requires proof of a fact not required by the other. I think the example that I give to the court will make this test clearer, but you will find the test laid down in paragraph 412 of that judgment. It is fair to say that in the ensuing years at the Yugoslav tribunal, differing views were taken about this particular test. But what we can say, what my submission is certainly in the limited time available to me, is that the current law is set out in a 2004 decision of the ICTY, which I've already mentioned, and that's the case of Cordic. What the appeals chamber said was this: what is required is an examination as a matter of law the elements of each offence in the statute pertain to that conduct for which the accused has been convicted. It must be considered whether each offence charged has a materially distinct element not contained in the other. That is, whether each offence has an element that requires proof of a fact not required by the other offence. And that, Your Honours, you will find in paragraph 1040 of the Court's judgment. So, for example, paragraph 1041 of that appeal's judgment addressing the crimes against humanity of persecution and murder. The judge has stated that persecution has these two elements. One, requirement of proof that an act or omission discriminates in fact. And two, proof that the act or omission was committed with specific intent to discriminate. Those are the two elements of persecution. The judges then address the crime against humanity of murder. Murder contains an element not contained in persecution. It is proof that the accused caused the death of one or more persons, regardless of whether the act or omission causing the death discriminates in fact or specifically intended as discrimination which is not required by persecutions. So the judges in that case were looking on the face of it on the elements required for the offences and finding that these two offences contain materially distinct elements. And this test has been applied as recently as last year in the Popovich decision, also the decision of the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal, and that you will find at paragraph number 78 of our list of authorities. The one crime which that judgment indicates the two crimes, the crimes that cannot be found together in that judgment are extermination and murder, because murder does not contain an element that's materially distinct from extermination. So murder under the current law would have to be cumulated, it would have to be subsumed into the crime of extermination, and that you will find in the Popovich judgment. Certainly the trial chamber applied that law in Popovich. Sentencing. I've been asked to consider, the co-prosecutors have been asked to consider the effect on sentencing. The Celibici case, which I've already mentioned, is quite helpful in terms of sentencing. It gives a summary of practices across many jurisdictions and obviously examines both civil law and common law systems and essentially comes very briefly to the conclusion that a sentence for cumulative convictions can be global, so a single sentence for a number of different offences. It can be concurrent, so a series of penalties running one after the other, or it can be consecutive in the sense that you can have multiple convictions and multiple sentences that run alongside each other. As you know, the trial chamber in this case essentially imposed a global sentence for all of the convictions, for the conviction of the crime against humanity and for the grave breaches. One issue, which is my submission, will not be a factor that has a great influence on the outcome, but I will mention it here. The crime against humanity of persecution requires a discriminatory intent. The other crimes against humanity that were the accused was found responsible but not ultimately convicted do not require discriminatory intent, and it has been found, and indeed the trial chamber found this too, that where that discriminatory intent for persecution exists, it is an aggravating factor in respect of those other crimes against humanity that do not require this special form of intent. I've also been asked very briefly the effect of cumulative convictions on the eligibility for early release, and it is our position that since this accused is not eligible for early release, it will not in any way affect him. The co-prosecutors have always maintained that he is not eligible for release. We maintain that now. It's solely for this court to enforce the respondent's sentence. Within the ad hoc tribunals, individuals were sent to serve their sentence in other jurisdictions where judges pointed out at the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal that those multiple convictions within that particular jurisdiction could have a detrimental effect on the accused. But since he will serve his sentence here, that is not of concern to us. Equally, two judges within the ICTY pointed out that the application of habitual offenders laws could also be of a valid concern, where if an individual is convicted of multiple offences and then serves a sentence in a jurisdiction which has a special penalty known as the habitual offenders penalty for multiple convictions, then of course that would be to his detriment. But again, this law, these comments specifically apply to the Rwanda and Yugoslav tribunals where individuals were sent to different jurisdictions in order to serve their sentence. I'm now, Your Honours, going to move on to the issue of rape as a discrete crime against humanity. We've been asked to explore whether rape was an autonomous crime against humanity under international law during the temporal jurisdiction of the court. The grounds of our appeal are contained in paragraphs 196 to 208. I would point out before I commence my submissions that the trial chamber did find that rape comprises a separate and recognised offence within ECC law and international criminal law, and by making these submissions I'm in no way disputing that finding, which is at paragraph 366 of the trial judgment. The trial chamber, as I've said, determines that one incident of rape should be categorised as a crime against humanity of torture. We submit that the trial chamber erred in law by failing to convict the respondent of rape. We note that the elements of the offence of rape as a discrete crime against humanity are the same as when rape is subsumed into torture, save for the additional legal requirements of torture. The test, what I'm saying here, Your Honours, is that the test is more stringent for rape when it's subsumed into torture than it would be for rape to be found as a discrete crime in itself. In the present case, where the elements are made out for torture as well, there would be no detriment to the rights of the accused if he were to be convicted of rape as well, and this would more accurately reflect the nature of the criminal conduct. We recognise that in a recent decision of the pre-trial chamber in the second case that will be heard by this court, that there was an examination of whether or not rape was a discrete crime against humanity. The pre-trial chamber in that case found that rape could not be prosecuted in this court in its own right, but that it could be prosecuted under the category of a crime against humanity
of inhumane acts.
We take issue with that characterization and that application of the principle of legality. Our argument, simply put, is that the principle of legality does not require that a crime has been prescribed in the exact and precise terms in which it is later prosecuted, as long as it was reasonably foreseeable and accessible to the accused that certain acts or omissions would entail international criminal liability. Thus, so long as it is established that the conduct of rape could constitute a crime against humanity. During 1975 to 1999, it's irrelevant whether the conduct would have been charged under the name of rape as a crime against humanity on the one hand or rape as an inhumane act on the other. As stated, the principle of legality is satisfied if the underlying criminal conduct is such as punishable, regardless of how the concrete charges in a specific law would have been formulated. So the question, in my respectful submission, that you should ask yourselves is whether conduct amounting to rape was punishable as a crime against humanity such that it was accessible and foreseeable that the accused could be prosecuted for crimes against humanity based on that conduct during the temporal jurisdiction of this court. It is our position that the accused could have reasonably foreseen that acts of rape could constitute a crime against humanity as of 1975. Why do I say that? In the Kunarak's decision, Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal, that's Authority 73 in our list of authorities, rape was described as one of the worst sufferings a human being can inflict upon another, and the court found that it had been long prohibited in customary international law. The pretrial chamber of this court further recognized itself that rape has long been prohibited as a war crime in international humanitarian law, and that is the decision on appeal by Nunchia and Ying Tariff of the closing order, and you'll find that at paragraph 151 of the pretrial chamber's judgment. We submit that the prohibition of rape as an autonomous crime against humanity gradually crystallized out of the prohibition of rape in authorities which actually date back to the 19th century. I do not have time to go through each one of these in detail, but very briefly, these authorities are those in fact that were cited by the pretrial chamber. It includes Article 44 of the Labour Code, which was a code of practice, a code that was put in place for the conduct of war during the American Civil War, and the federal authorities expressly prohibited rape being committed by their own armed forces. The regulations annexed to the 1907 Hague Conventions, the Geneva Conventions of 1949, the Additional Protocol of 1977, and the Additional Protocol also of 1977. All of these instruments prohibit sexual violence and rape. Other sources that further evidence the gradual prohibition of rape in customary international law is the 1919 Commission of Responsibility of the Authors of War and Enforcement of Penalties. This was a report that was produced by the victorious powers at the end of the First World War. The recommendations were to bring, in particular, the Emperor of Germany and German officers to trial for crimes committed during the First World War. Rape was listed fifth amongst the 32 charges enumerated by that commission. Now, it is fair to say that no trials actually took place as a result of that commission's report. There were trials conducted by the German authorities, but there was a lack of political will to have international trials. Nevertheless, that is what the great powers at that time agreed
ពេលវេលាមួយដែលយើងបានយល់ស្របថាបទល្មើសនេះមានចែងនៅក្នុងច្បាប់
1945
បទល្មើសសត្វព្រៃត្រូវបានចាត់ទុកថាជាអង្គកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិ
នៅក្នុងមាត្រា2 A law that was promulgated to try and make a bulk of war criminals in Germany after the war, the International Military Tribunal convicted senior members of the Nazi regime control council law number 10 was set up as a condition to try the vast majority of individuals who were susceptible to prosecution for war crimes and crimes against humanity.
Now,
again, whilst those provisions of Control Council Law No. 10 contained rape as a crime against humanity, no accused was tried for the crime of rape.
មិនមានជនជាតិណាត្រូវបានផ្តន្ទាទោសទៅលើបទល្មើសរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវិនិច្ឆ័យ
That said, scholars have indeed pointed out that evidence was in fact heard during the main trial of the International Military Tribunal for rape, whilst it wasn't classified as an inhumane act because within the charter of the Nuremberg Court of the International Military Tribunal, rape was regarded as an inhumane act. Nevertheless, evidence of rape was heard in that case. And indeed, moreover, the International Military Tribunal for the Far East also included inhumane acts. And evidence also was heard in that case of rape. Now, moving forward in time, and we must move forward rapidly, and I must move forward rapidly because I'm running out of time. Both the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal and the Rwanda Tribunal provided for the prosecution of rape as an autonomous crime against humanity. Although these instruments, the statutes that established these courts, enumerated these crimes in the early 1990s, there had been no development of the law in respect of rape between the end of the Second World War and the beginning of the 1990s. The first international criminal prosecution for rape as a crime against humanity was in the Acquiescu case. The trial chamber in Acquiescu decided in their 1998 judgment that rape was an autonomous crime against humanity. In doing so, pioneering and courageous judges of that trial chamber recognized the horrors of sexual violence and the lasting silent human destruction both to individuals and to our societies. Subsequently, the findings of the Rwanda Tribunal with respect to the status of rape as a crime against humanity were confirmed by the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal in addressing the horrors of the Kunarac case.
ហើយក្នុងនោះក៏យើងមានលើកឡើងក្នុងរឿងដីខុនរ៉ាក់ហើយជាពិសេសតឡាកាសេរ៉ាលីអូនន
េះក៏បានរកឃើញពីនេះដែរព្រះញ្ញាសូមលើកឡើងថាវាជាការសំស្របតាមតឡាកាដែលថាត្រូវតែ
កំណត់នៅយុត្តាធិការទៅលើបញ្ហាទាំងអស់នោះ
បន្ទុកត្រៃយូណូតឡាកាអាចជាតឡាការវ៉ាឬក៏តឡាកាពិសេសសម្រាប់សេរ៉ាលីអូនមិនបានកំណត់ចំណុចជាក់លាក់ថាអាចជាការសំស្របតាមតឡាកាIt is my submission that it must have occurred in the wake of the Second World War at the latest, because as I've said, there were no significant conventional or jurisprudential developments related to crime against humanity of rape between 1945 and 1993. The trial chamber of this court has established that reliance on decisions of tribunals post-1979 does not contravene the principle of legality. So looking forward to decisions that were made later to interpret the law that came from behind is something that the trial chamber has said is lawful, and I would ask you respectfully to do the same. Because that guidance provides interpretation to the evolving status of certain offences and forms of responsibility internationally. Similarly, the Yugoslav Tribunal in Hadzianovic noted that the principle of legality, jurisprudence in the European Court of Human Rights, allows for the gradual clarification of the rules of criminal liability through judicial interpretation and reflects the understanding that it's not necessary that the elements of an offence are defined, but rather that general description of the prohibited conduct be provided. Now, in my submission, this makes absolute sense to allow a process of gradual explanation of international norms through judicial interpretation, considering the nature of the international legal system, where norms have not been codified in the manner that offences would be codified in a domestic system. International law, Your Honours, as you know, is not a product of domestic statute. There's no world authority yet that's empowered to enact statutes of universal application. It's elucidated often through judicial decisions to find, otherwise to apply strict domestic principles would have strangled international law at birth. For this court to find that rape was not part of customary international law would, in my submission, also undermine the consistent findings of international criminal tribunals, which allow for rape to be prosecuted as an autonomous crime against humanity. The determination of the international tribunals in respect of rape rests upon the same authorities that are available to you, Your Honours. As I've said, there were no significant developments between 79 and 93. In sum, Your Honours, there is no reason to depart from the criminalisation of rape as a crime against humanity in the law in this court. In particular, very briefly, both prongs of the principle of legality stand and are satisfied. With respect to foreseeability, the pre-trial chambers found that a charged person must be able to appreciate that the conduct is criminal in the sense generally understood without reference to any specific provision. Applying that standard to the present case, the co-prosecutor submits that the prohibition of rape in international customary law was sufficiently developed in 1975 such that the accused could have foreseen that acts of rape constituted a crime against humanity. The fact that the crime previously may have been charged in a less specific fashion is irrelevant for the legality analysis, since the underlying conduct is exactly the same. The second prong of the test is the legality test. The second prong of the legality test, I'm sorry, is the accessibility requirement. And the pre-trial chamber has recognised that with respect to the accessibility prong, reliance can be placed on a law which is based on custom. Here, the information necessary to come to this conclusion that rape was punishable as a crime against humanity in customary international law was public and accessible. Just because it wasn't in a domestic statute does not mean to say that the accused can argue that he didn't have access to that law. It was established in international customary law by the time of this offence. An analogy can be made to the practice of the Yugoslavian Rwanda tribunals, where perpetrators of rape in the context of widespread and systematic horrific attacks in the former Yugoslavia were found to have had sufficient notice that their conduct amounted to a crime against humanity, that sexual violence, that those rapes was a crime against humanity, and they knew it. Lastly, international criminal jurisprudence establishes that immorality or the appalling character of an act must play a role in warranting the criminalisation of that act, insofar as it can refute any claim that an accused did not know that the conduct that he was performing was criminal. And that you will find in the Milutinovic decision, at paragraph 42, that's an appeals chamber decision of the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal. Now I will move rapidly to enslavement. The Chamber has requested submissions from us on the issue of enslavement, and in particular regarding the apparent discrepancy between the closing orders charging of enslavement, which appears to charge enslavement with respect to certain detainees rather than all detainees, and the argument in the OCP's appeal that enslavement occurred with respect to all of the detainees in S21. In respect to the definition of enslavement, I would refer to paragraph 342 of the trial chamber's judgment on reflection. I think perhaps our position on appeal was overstated. I think, in fact, that the trial chamber did find that enslavement could take place without forced labour. I think that just in these particular circumstances they found that enslavement was taking place with the element of forced labour. In any event, our position on the law is contained in our submissions, and I won't repeat that here. It's always been the position of the co-prosecutors that all detainees were enslaved in S21, and you can find the submissions in paragraph 273-274 of our final submission to That submission clearly identifies also both the groups forced to work at S24 and all of the detainees at S21 as having been enslaved. Now, the closing order from OCIJ, as I've already stated, says the following. I'll read it. Certain detainees at S21 and Praesar were forced to work. Strict control and constructive ownership was exercised over all aspects of their lives. By limiting their movement and physical environment, taking measures to prevent and deter their escape, and subjecting them to cruel treatment and abuse. As a result of these acts, detainees were stripped of their free will. Now, I will accept immediately how this chamber may come to the conclusion that the investigating judges were limiting or establishing a subset of individuals who were subjected to enslavement and didn't involve anybody. But I would make the following submission. Certainly, if you read all of the preambular paragraphs in the closing order prior to paragraph 135, I won't have time to go through all of them, but certainly if you look at paragraphs 62, 63, 66, 66, and that's in respect of Tul Sleng, S21. The judges address facts which are clearly enslavement, not based on forced labour. Prisoners being blindfolded and handcuffed. Prisoners being restrained for 24 hours a day. One prisoner, Chun Mei, explained that he was not allowed to stand up. Rules governing the lives of prisoners, depriving them of their most basic human needs. Unable to speak to each other or to the guards. Prisoners shackled when bathed. My submission is that even though paragraph 135 appears to limit the group, if you look at the last sentence, it states, as a result of these acts, detainees were stripped of their free will. My submission, Your Honours, is that these paragraphs should be read as a narrative, in the sense that all of the facts that referred to beforehand are actually incorporated in paragraph 135. If you read the whole thing as a narrative, what actually happened at S21 and S24. And I think the final sentence of paragraph 135 supports my argument in this respect. In any event, Your Honours, if you don't accept that argument, it is my submission that you do have the authority as the trial chamber did to recharacterize this particular charge that's provided for by Rule 110.2 of the Rules of Procedure of the Internal Regulations of that court.
របស់តុលាការដែលចែងថា
សារក្រមត្រូវតែកំណត់ទៅលើអង្គហេតុដែលមានចែងmay change the legal characterization of the crime
is set out in the indictment as long as no new
constitutive elements
are introduced. ជំរះរកឃើញនៅធាតសំណាមួយដែលអាចយកមកអះអាងបាន
In terms, as I've already said, of the element of force labor, whether or not one takes the position that the trial chamber erroneously inserted force labor into the definition of enslavement, or whether or not they said enslavement could take place with or without forced labor, it is our position that forced labor is not a requirement for enslavement, and that this chamber can enter a conviction for the enslavement of all of the detainees
who were detained at S21.
Next.I will move very briefly the time I have left to making submissions on the factual elements of extermination and enslavement in the facts of this case. This, of course, goes back to what I was saying earlier about cumulative convictions.
And what I will do is simply outline for you the materially distinct elements of the offence of extermination and the offence of enslavement.
Extermination requires an act or omission or a combination of each that results in the death of the other. That's not an element of enslavement. Enslavement requires the exercising of powers attaining to rights of ownership over a human being. That's not an element of extermination.
Now,
in terms of the facts of this case, one can distinguish between those facts where conditions of detention led to death,which can be extermination, and then conditions of detention that essentially were enslavement. Again, very briefly, those conditions of detention which led to enslavement, you will find in the closing order of paragraph 66, paragraph 63, paragraph 62, and paragraph 64. Thus, it is my submission that both the distinction between extermination and enslavement would allow for a conviction for both offences, and moreover, that the facts that the trial chamber found and indeed are contained in the closing order would support those two different convictions. There were individuals, very few I know, who survived the conditions of detention at S21. Many people perished, it's true. But there were some individuals who survived and were subjected to conditions of detention that amounted to enslavement. Very, very briefly, Your Honours, because I think I'm probably almost out of time. I have 3 minutes left, I'm told. The issue of persecution as a crime against humanity. We tend to support the findings of the trial chamber. There's not a great deal we can add, I could very quickly go through the customary international law, the findings of the trial chamber at paragraphs 374 to 396 in respect of crimes against humanity and persecution. But I think it is safe to say that by 1975, bearing in mind all of the customary international law that preceded that point in time, persecutions was well established in international criminal law. Article 6 of the Charter of the International Military Tribunal found that persecution on political, racial, or religious grounds is a crime against humanity. Article 5 of the Charter of the International Military Tribunal for the Far East found that persecution on political or racial grounds was a crime against humanity. The UN General Assembly Resolution 3 states, taking note of the definition of war crimes and crimes against peace and against humanity contained in the Charter of the IMT, dated 8th of August 1945, and essentially approves of the IMT Charter the fact that persecution, implicitly that persecution, was found to be a crime against humanity in the IMT Charter. The UN General Assembly Resolution 95, which affirmed the principles of international law, recognized by the Charter of the Nuremberg Tribunal, again, as I keep repeating, but where persecution has been found to be a crime against humanity. UN General Assembly Resolution 2391 describing crimes against humanity as being amongst the gravest of international law, and providing that crimes against humanity, whether committed in time of war or peace, as they are defined in the Charter of the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg on the 8th of August 1945. Persecution was also included as a crime against humanity in the ILC Draft Code of Offences against the Peace and Security of Mankind. Find that in Article 2, Subarticle 10, persecution on political, racial, or religious or cultural grounds. Also in the 1954 draft, Article 211, inhuman acts such as, etc., persecution committed against any civilian population or social, political, racial, religious or cultural grounds. Also, and the persecution was also incorporated in Control Council Law number 10 as a crime against humanity, as I mentioned to you earlier, was the body set up by the Allied powers, by the Soviet Union, France, the United States, and the United Kingdom, to try the bulk of the lesser war criminals compared to the International Military Tribunal. In 1961, in Israel, Adolf Eichmann was found guilty of crimes against humanity, including persecution of the Jews on national, racial, religious and political grounds. And in 1985, the French courts allowed for the issuance of an indictment for persecutions against innocent Jews committed during the Second World War. I think I've run out of my time now, but it is my submission that by 1975, the crime of persecution as a crime against humanity was well established in international customary law.
សូមអញ្ជើញសហមេតវីការពារក្តីជន់ជាប់ចោតបាទធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងតបបាទជាបឋមសូមគ្រប់លោកប្រធានតុលាការកំពូលនិងអង្គជំនុំទេសតុលាការកំពូលទាំងមូលដែលហេតុថាកូនខ្ញុំជាមេតវីតំណាងផលប្រយោជន៍ឲ្យជន់ជាប់ចោតកាន់កិច្ចយោហឺដូចហើយយើងបានសន្មតថាអវតកអត់មានយថាធិការលើបុគ្គលកាន់កិច្ចយោហឺដូចនេះទេ ដោយតែយើងបានពិភាក្សាពីម្សិលមិញអញ្ចឹងហេតុនេះហើយជាដើមហេតុដែលយើងមិនដាក់សារណាជាលិលិអសឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងអ្វីដែលជាសារណាដែលជាបណ្ដឹងសារទុករបស់សហប្រញ្ញាទៅមកកាន់តុលាការកំពូលនេះបាទនេះជាដើមហេតុដែលយើងមិនដាក់សារណាជាលិលិអសប៉ុន្តែដែលហេតុថាយើងបានទទួលនៅការបង្គាប់ ជាធម្មមានរូបពីតឡាការកំពូលឲ្យយើងក្រុមយើងខ្ញុំធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសហប្រញ្ញាប៉ុន្តែអំបញ្ញមិញនេះខ្ញុំទើបបានទទួលដំណឹងពីកងដីខ្ញុំគឺគាត់នៅតែរក្សាចំហសុំឲ្យបដិសេធមិនឆ្លើយតបប៉ុន្តែដោយការបញ្យលរបស់យើងខ្ញុំអំពីផលប្រយោជន៍របស់គាត់ទើបគាត់អនុញ្ញាតឲ្យយើងឆ្លើយតបដោយខ្លីៗដូច្នេះខ្ញុំនៅឈរចន្លោះរវាងកាតព្វកិច្ចច្បាប់ដែលត្រូវគោរពតឡាការកំពូលហើយនឹងកាតព្វកិច្ចត្រូវគោរពផលប្រយោជន៍កងដីខ្ញុំផងដែរហេតុនេះខ្ញុំមិនធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ណាមួយមិនឆ្ងាយពេកទេតបទៅនឹងសហប្រញ្ញាបាទការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងឧកតកម្មប្រឆាំងនយោបាយនៃកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិទោះបីជាថាដំណើរការនៃសាលាជំនះក្តីអន្តរជាតិនានាដែលបង្កើតបានជាច្បាប់ទំនៀមទម្លាប់អន្តរជាតិនៅលើពិភពលោកនាងនេះមិនបានកំណត់ច្បាស់លាស់អំពីនយោបាយនៃកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិយ៉ាងណាក៏ដោយក៏យើងរកបានវានៅក្នុងមាត្រា188នៃក្រមព្រហ្មទណ្ឌកម្ពុជាដែលចែងថាបទឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិគឺជាអំពើមួយក្នុងចំណោមអំពើដែលរៀបរាប់ខាងក្រោមនេះការបើអំពើនេះត្រូវបានប្រព្រឹត្តក្នុងក្របខ័ណ្ឌនៃការវាយលុកជាទូទៅឬជាប្រព័ន្ធសម្ដៅប្រជាជនស៊ីវិលឃាតកម្មការសម្លាប់រង្គាលការធ្វើទៅជាទាសករការនិទេសឬជំលះដោយបង្ខំការដាក់ពន្ធនាគារឬគ្រប់រូបភាពដតីទៀតនៃការដកហូតយ៉ាងធ្ងន់ធ្ងរនៃសេរីភាពដោយបំពានលើបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃគ្រឹះនៃនីតិអន្តរជាតិការធ្វើទារុណកម្មការចាប់បង្ខំរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈការធ្វើទាសកម្មខាងផ្លូវភេទពេទ្យាចារដោយបង្ខំការមានគាត់ដោយបង្ខំវចនកម្មដោយបង្ខំនិងរូបគ្រប់រូបភាពផ្សេងទៀតនៃអំពើហិង្សាខាងផ្លូវភេទដែលមានទម្ងន់ប្រាក់ប្រហែលគ្នាការធ្វើទុកបុកម្នេញលើក្រុមឬសមូហភាពដោយមូលហេតុនយោបាយពុជសាសក្រុមជាតិពុនវប្បធម៌សាសនាឬភេទការធ្វើឲ្យបាត់ខ្លួនដោយបង្ខំការអនុវត្តនយោបាយប្រកាន់ពុជសាសជាប្រព័ន្ធតាមបែបអបថេតការគ្រប់អំពើអមនុស្សធម៌ផ្សេងទៀតដែលបង្កឲ្យមានការឈឺចាប់យ៉ាងខ្លាំងឬការប៉ះពាល់យ៉ាងធ្ងន់ធ្ងរលើបរណភាពខាងរូបកាយតឡាការជាទីគោរពខ្ញុំនៅតែរំលឹកថាខ្ញុំកំពុងតែឈរចាំចំណុចកណ្ដាលនៃប្រទេសដែលប្រើប្រាស់ប្រព័ន្ធច្បាប់ស៊ីវីលហេតុនេះអត្តន័យនៃការដកស្រង់សេចក្តីសម្រេចចិត្តរបស់តឡាការផ្សេងផ្សេងទៀតជាករណីយុទ្ធសាស្ត្រដែលប្រាក់ធ្លាប់ប្រើប្រាស់ក្នុងប្រព័ន្ធកមិនឡគួរគប្បីនឹងពិចារណាថាគួរទាត់ចោលក៏ប៉ុន្តែដើម្បីលើកតម្លៃនៃបទដ្ឋានច្បាប់អន្តរជាតិនិងការអប់រំជាទូទៅក្នុងអំពីច្បាប់យើងក៏សង្កេតឃើញនូវធាតុផ្សំបទប្រកាសប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិថាវាត្រូវទាមទារឲ្យមានធាតុផ្សំពីរសំខាន់សំខាន់ទៀតដែលបន្ថែមទៅលើធាតុចេតនាគឺធាតុចេតនាហើយនិងធាតុសច្ចានុម័តធាតុចេតនាគឺបរិកិដ្ឋប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិទៀនទីឲ្យមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធគឺមានបទបញ្ជាពីលើចុះទៅក្រោមហើយនឹងការរាយការណ៍ពីក្រោមឡើងមកលើវិញទី1ទី2ធាតុសច្ចានុម័តទៀនទីឲ្យវាមានលក្ខណៈជាទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំបាទជាភាសាអង់គ្លេសប្រាថ្មាសបើសិនជាការសម្លាប់ដូចជារៀបរាប់ក្នុងមាត្រា183មិញគឺការសម្លាប់ជាទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំហើយបើមានការរំលោភក៏រំលោភជាទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំដែរហើយបើការដាក់ទាសករគឺអធិសករជាទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំនឹងមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធដូច្នេះធៀបផ្សំពីរសំខាន់ណាស់ដែលត្រូវលើកមកពិភាក្សាគឺជាប្រព័ន្ធនិងជាទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំវាស្របតាមមាត្រា188នៃក្រមព្រហ្មទណ្ឌកម្ពុជាបច្ចុប្បន្នហើយក៏ស្របទៅតាមធម្មនុញ្ញរបស់សាលាជំនះក្តីនរមបឺនិងតូក្យូផងដែរការលើកឡើងនេះខ្ញុំចង់ទាញឧទាហរណ៍បង្ហាញអំពីការរំលោភសត្វសន្តិវៈឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសារណារបស់សហប្រញ្ញាថានៅស21មានការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈដែលចាត់ទុកថាជាធៀបសំនៅកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិការលើកឡើងបែបនេះដូចជាគ្មានទាន់ហើយក៏ណាបញ្ជាក់ច្បាស់លាស់សោះជាទម្លាប់របស់សហប្រញ្ញានៅសាលាជំនះក្តីនេះកាលណាគាត់លើកឡើងមិនដែលទាញបង្ហាញផតតាំងច្បាស់លាស់ណាមួយចូលយកមកបង្ហាញយើងទេហើយក៏មិនបង្ហាញអត្ថបទច្បាប់ដែរក្រៅតែនិយាយដដែលអំពីសាលាជំនះក្តីយូហ្គោស្លាវីតែប៉ុណ្ណោះនៅមន្ទីរស21មានករណីរំលោភតែមួយករណីគត់ហើយការរំលោភមួយករណីគត់នេះគឺមិនមែនមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធនឹងទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំទេដោយតែធៀបផ្សំនៃបាត់ល្មើសឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិដូច្នេះហើយការរំលោភមួយករណីនេះវាមិនមែនជាធៀបមួយនៃធៀបផ្សំឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិបានទេពីព្រោះថារំលោភមួយករណីនេះដូចបានចាត់វិធានការដោយផ្ទាល់ខ្លួនរបស់គាត់ទី1គាត់បានរាយការណ៍ទៅថ្នាក់លើរបស់គាត់សុនសេនសុំវិធានការចាត់ការចំពោះជនជាប់ចោតរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈនេះ នៅពេលដែលសុនសេនមិនធ្វើធ្វើការមិននឹងមិនលឺចំពោះចម្លើយតចំពោះសំណើរបស់លោកកង្កិច្ចហើយដូចសុបើដូចខ្លួនឯងនេះបានចាត់វិធានការរដ្ឋបាលដែលអស់ពីសមត្ថភាពគាត់ដោយផ្លាស់អ្នកទោសអ្នកសួរចម្លើយសំទោសដោយផ្លាស់អ្នកសួរចម្លើយជាមនុស្សប្រុសឲ្យមកអ្នកសួរចម្លើយជាមនុស្សស្រីវិញនេះជាវិធានការរាំងស្កាត់ការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈដូច្នេះវាមិនមែនមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធទេលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធបានន័យថាប្រព្រឹត្តដោយរដ្ឋាភិបាលបាទតែចំពោះការបង្កើតគុកការធ្វើទារុណកម្មដែលមានលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធយើងអត់បដិសេធទេចំពោះកម្មកម្មប្រឆាំងមួយជាតិនៅស21ដូច្នេះយើងត្រូវពិចារណាផងតែមួយករណីគត់ហេតុដូចម្ដេចក៏គេមិនចាប់ប្រកាន់រដ្ឋាភិបាលបច្ចុប្បន្នឲ្យជាប់ចោតពីកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិគ្រាន់តែព្រឹកមិញនេះលោកអានកាសែតខ្ញុំឃើញពីម្សិលមិញដល់ថ្ងៃនេះជាង10ករណីគ្រាន់តែការរំលោភអញ្ចឹងយើងអាចចាត់ទុកថានេះជាការយកកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិទេចម្លើយថាគ្មានទេប៉ុន្តែនៅNuremberg ហើយនឹងនៅតូក្យូវាមានករណីផ្សេងពីនេះឯនៅយូហ្គោស្លាវីក៏ដូចគ្នាដែរដោយហេតុថាចក្រមនៅទីនេះមានជនជាតិជប៉ុនម្នាក់សូមគោរពនិងសូមអភ័យទោសពីលោកជំនន់គឺថាការរំលោភរបស់យោធាជប៉ុននៅណានគីងគឺនៅទីក្រុងចិនគឺមានមែនទ្រង់ទ្រាយបែបនេះទេដែលគេកំណត់ថាវាជាឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិនោះគឺការរំលោភនិងដាក់ទាសករស្ត្រីនៅជនជាតិចិននឹងជាទាសករសម្រាប់ទាហានជប៉ុននឹងគឺទ្រង់ទ្រាយធំតែម្ដងហើយការបបៀតបៀនផ្លូវភេទគួរសាហាវព្រៃផ្សាយសម្បំថាដែរមិនមែនដោយករណីនៅស21នោះទេទី2នៅយូហ្គោស្លាវីនៅយូហ្គោស្លាវីទាហានរបស់ស្លូមីដានមីឡូសូវិចរំលោភដោយអត់រើសមុខទៅលើអំបោចជនជាតិភាគតិចអាល់បានីដែលកាន់សាសនាអ៊ីស្លាមហើយគាត់ដឹងថាការរំលោភបែបនេះបង្កឲ្យមានបញ្ហាទាំងរូបកាយនិងផ្លូវចិត្តពីព្រោះជនជាតិអំបោអាល់បានីដែលកាន់សាសនាអ៊ីស្លាមនេះគឺមានការតាំងរឹងណាស់អំពីការប៉ះពាល់ផ្នែកផ្លូវភេទនេះធ្វើឲ្យសហគមន៍គាត់ទាត់គាត់ចោលទៀតផងនេះហើយជាការជិះចាប់ផ្លូវកាយហើយមេបញ្ជាការនៃកងទ័ពយូហ្គោស្លាវីក្រោមបញ្ជារបស់ស្រូមម៉ាដាំមីឡូសូវិចមិនដែលចាត់វិធានការម្ដងណាទល់នឹងបុគ្គលិកយោធារបស់គាត់នោះទេនេះហើយបាទមានកលៈបែបបង្ហាញថាធៀបសំនៃធៀបចេតនាហ្នឹងគឺចេតនាចេញពីរដ្ឋាភិបាលទៅតែម្ដងឲ្យអ្នកនោះអនុវត្តដែលមានការលើកទឹកចិត្តញុះញង់ឬបង្ខំបញ្ជាឬក៏ដោយការសន្យាឬក៏ធ្វើមិនដឹងមិនលឺតែម្ដងហើយឯទងទ្រាយការរំលោភគឺទងទ្រាយធំដោយខ្ញុំបានលើកដោយកងថាប្រព្រឹត្តដោយកងទ័ពជប៉ុនហើយនិងកងទ័ពរបស់ស្លូមម៉ាដាំមីឡូសូវិចយ៉ាងដូចនេះដែរការដាក់ជាទាសករការដាក់ជាទាសករនិយមន័យរបស់ច្បាប់អន្តរជាតិគឺអត់ច្បាស់ដូចគ្នាប៉ុន្តែមានក្នុងវាជាធៀបសំមួយនៃធៀបសំទាំងឡាយក្នុងឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិក្នុងមាត្រា188ដូចគ្នាប៉ុន្តែតាមទំនៀមទម្លាប់អន្តរជាតិដែលយើងព្យាយាមមិនលើកវាមកបង្ហាញគឺថាការអប់រំជាទូទៅគឺការដាក់ជាទាសករនេះគឺសំដៅលើការរឹបអូសទ្រព្យសម្បត្តិទៀតផងមិនមែនឲ្យពលកម្មដោយបង្ខំនោះតែមួយនោះទេដែលជាធៀបសំការរឹបអូសយកទ្រព្យសម្បត្តិសិទ្ធិជាសារវ័នរបស់បុគ្គលនឹងការដាក់បង្ខំដោយពលកម្មដែលអត់មានផលប្រយោជន៍ប៉ុន្តែជាទូទៅលោកយើងត្រូវសួរខ្លួនយើងថាគ្រប់មន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងទាំងអស់នៃពិភពលោកនេះដែលទោសដាក់ឲ្យធ្វើការដោយពលកម្មដោយជាតម្ងន់ទោសអស់មួយជីវិតហើយធ្វើពលកម្មជាតម្ងន់ដូចជានៅចិននៅសហរដ្ឋអាមេរិកនោះតើវាជាធៀបសំនៃបទអក្រិតប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិដែរទេចម្លើយថាទេគឺវាមិនអាចទេដូច្នេះការចាប់យកចំណុចតែមួយរបស់សហប្រជាញាមកចោទថាការអនុវត្តនៅស24ចំពោះពលកម្មដែលអត់មានតម្លៃតបស្នងហើយដាក់រដ្ឋបတ်ចំពោះសិទ្ធិសេរីភាពរបស់ជនរងគ្រោះនៅស24នោះថាជាទាសករគឺមិនត្រឹមត្រូវទេពីព្រោះថាមន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងណាក៏ដូចតែគ្នាដែរកាលណាគេដាក់គុកហើយគឺបានគេកាត់សេរីភាពមិនឲ្យដើរឆ្វេងឆ្វាយទេបើដើរបានតាមចិត្តមិនមែនមន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងទេហើយការធ្វើពលកម្មនេះនៅក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដូចយើងបានដឹងស្រាប់ហើយគឺធ្វើស្មើគ្នាទាំងអស់មិនមែនអ្នកជាប់ឃុំទេដែលធ្វើស្មើគ្នាហើយមិនមែនតែអ្នកជាប់ឃុំទេដែលត្រូវកាត់របបអាហារគឺយើងអ្នកប្រជាជនទូទៅក៏កាត់របបអាហារដែររួមទាំងកម្មាភិបាលថ្នាក់កណ្ដាលរបស់របបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យផងដែរដូច្នេះគ្មានទេធៀបចេតនាដែលដាក់ជាជាសកលនៅស21មុខងារសំខាន់របស់ស21ដោយតែកូនក្ដីរបស់ខ្ញុំបាទកាំងកាជាដោយគាត់បានសារភាពហើយគាត់បានបដិសេធទេអំពើទារុណកម្មនៅទីនោះពេលពិតជាកើតមានមុខងារសំខាន់របស់ស21គឺសួរចម្លើយហើយសម្លាប់តែពីរនឹងគត់ឯស24គឺជាវិធានការរដ្ឋបាលដាក់ចំពោះតែ បុគ្គលិករដ្ឋបាលរបស់គាត់ដែលប្រព្រឹត្តវិន័យខុសវិន័យស្រាលស្រាលតែប៉ុណ្ណោះដែលមានសំណាងណាឲ្យបានទៅនៅសម24នោះបាទវាមិនបម្រើឲ្យមុខងារក្នុងការដាក់ជាទេសកលទេស21ក៏ដូចឲ្យស24ដែរស21មានតែម្យ៉ាងគាត់គឺសួរចម្លើយរាយការណ៍ថ្នាក់លើចប់សម្រាប់ចោលចាប់ហើយចូលស21គ្មានថ្ងៃចេញទេបាទនេះជាទឹកតាំងជាផុសតាំងដែលបញ្ជាក់ថាស21អវត្តមានការដាក់ជាទេសកលប៉ុន្តែសំណួរសួរថាតើយើងបដិសេធទេកតកម្មឆាំងមួយមនុស្សជាតិនៅស21ផ្សេងៗទៀតក្រៅពីការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈនិងកតិទេសកលមេធាវីមិនធ្វើសេចក្តីសន្ថានតបនឹងសហប្រាជ្ញាទេចំពោះបញ្ហានេះហើយកូនក្តីរបស់ខ្ញុំបាទក៏មិនឆ្លើយតបនឹងបញ្ហានេះដែរពីព្រោះថាគាត់បានសារភាពអស់ទៅហើយនៅឯសាលាដំបងរបស់អវតកឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសហប្រាជ្ញាចំពោះការសារណារបស់ប្រាជ្ញាដែលនិយាយអំពីទុះសោកការកាត់ទោសស្របគឺជាឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិរបស់សហជីវក្រមស្របតាមមាត្រា39ថ្មីនៃច្បាប់អវតកដែលកំណត់ទោសអុកតត្រូវផ្តន្ទាទោសពី5ឆ្នាំដល់1ជីវិតហេតុនេះឲ្យតែតុលាការសម្រេចកំណត់ទោសចន្លោះពី5ឆ្នាំទៅទោសអស់1ជីវិតគឺវាអត់ខុសនឹងនិចានខលនៃទោសទេហេតុអីក៏ថាគាត់សម្រេចខុសព្រោះទោសនេះវានៅចន្លោះពីនឹងអុកតកម្មឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិទោះជាដកទាសកលចេញដកការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈចេញក៏នៅតែមានធៀបសំនៃបទល្មើសឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មឆាំងរុស្ស៊ីពេញលេងដែរហើយទោសពី5ឆ្នាំទៅអស់មួយជីវិតគឺជាការដាក់ទោសត្រឹមត្រូវប៉ុន្តែស្ថានភាពកូនក្តីខ្ញុំដែលខ្ញុំបានតវ៉ាចំពោះការបដន្តទោសក្នុងបណ្ដឹងសារទុកគឺថាដាក់ទោស35ឆ្នាំគឺវាធ្ងន់ធ្ងរហួសចំពោះគុណភាពកូនក្តីខ្ញុំបាទដែលសារភាពនឹងធ្វើការសហការយ៉ាងល្អជាមួយតុលាការជាសមានគុណភាពជាសាក្សីផងហើយត្រូវកាត់ទោសដោយធ្វើស្តង់ដាបាទភាសាព្រះអញ្ញាបានថា double standard ប្រើស្តង់ដាធ្វើចំពោះកូនក្តីខ្ញុំដូចដែលយើងលើកពីម្សិលមិញហើយ195គុកទៀតអត់យកមកកាត់ទោសទេយកតែមួយមកកាត់ទោសហើយមួយនេះសហការល្អណាស់ជាមួយតុលាការបានបង្ហាញទាំងអស់ឲ្យតុលាការដំណើរការបានដោយរលូនគាត់ត្រូវតែទទួលបាននៅស្ថានសម្រាលបើគាត់ត្រូវទទួលបានស្ថានសម្រាលចន្លោះតាមក្រមព្រំដែនកម្ពុជាស្ថានសម្រាលនេះត្រូវកំណត់ពី15ឆ្នាំទៅ30ឆ្នាំហេតុនេះការដាក់ទោសគាត់ដល់35ឆ្នាំគឺលើសដល់5ឆ្នាំទៅទៀតវាគួរតែស្ថិតនៅក្នុងការពិចារណាមួយដែលអង្គជំនុំនិងសាលាការកំពូលគួរពិចារណានោះគឺថាផ្ដល់ស្ថានសម្រាលឲ្យគាត់តែកម្រិតអបបរមាគឺ15ឆ្នាំគឺគ្រប់គ្រាន់ណាស់ហើយបាទហើយនេះខ្ញុំមិនធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍វែងតទៅទៀតទេព្រោះមិនមែនជាគោលចំហរបស់សហមេធាវីដើម្បីឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសហប្រាជ្ញាចំពោះសារណារបស់សារណាបណ្ដឹងតទៅរបស់សហប្រាជ្ញាឡើយព្រោះយើងនៅតែយល់ថាអវតកអត់មានយថាធិការលើបកគោលកង្កិចអ៊ីដូចទេប៉ុន្តែដោយហេតុថាយើងបានទទួលនៅប័ណ្ណនៅបញ្ជារបស់តុលាការកំពូលឲ្យឆ្លើយតបហេតុនេះខ្ញុំសំណូមពរជាចុងក្រោយចំពោះការឆ្លើយតបរបស់ខ្ញុំនេះថាវាមិនមែនជាគោលចំហពិតប្រាកដរបស់យើងទេប៉ុន្តែដោយតម្រូវតាមទីតិវិធីខ្ញុំសំណូមពរសូមឲ្យតុលាការមេត្តាតុលាការកំពូលមេត្តាពិនិត្យពិចារណាលើស្ថានសម្រាប់ទោសមេត្តាសូមឲ្យតុលាការកំពូលមេត្តាពិចារណាស្ថានសម្រាប់ទោសតាមក្រមព្រំដែនកម្ពុជាឆ្នាំ2009ដែលកម្រិតទោសអបអបរមាត្រឹម15ឆ្នាំ
នេះតើទៅបញ្ហាការកំណត់ទោសនេះគឺយើងនៅធ្វើនៅវគ្គក្រោយដូច្នេះចាំធ្វើសារណាតបនៅពេលក្រោយបាទ
អរគុណ
លោកហប្រញ្ញាមានអីថាមេធាវីមានអីបន្ថែមទេ
សូមគោរពឯកឧត្តមប្រធានសូមគោរពលោកចៅក្រមជាតិនិងអន្តរជាតិនិងសូមគោរពអង្គសវនការទាំងមូលខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតធ្វើការបកស្រាយបន្តិចអំពីអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិយោងតាមមាត្រា129ថ្មីរដ្ឋធម្មនុញ្ញនៃប្រជាណាចក្រកម្ពុជាដែលបានចែងថាជំរះក្តីយុត្តិធម៌គឺត្រូវធ្វើតាមនីតិវិធីនិងតាមច្បាប់ជាធរមានហើយតុលាការអវតកយើងនេះជាតុលាការរបស់ជាតិត្រូវតែអនុវត្តតាមច្បាប់ជាតិហើយបើតាមច្បាប់ជាតិក្រមព្រហ្មទណ្ឌឆ្នាំ2009ត្រង់មាត្រា188បានឲ្យនិយមន័យច្បាស់លាស់ណាស់អំពីអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិដោយបានបញ្ជាក់អំពីធាតុផ្សំរបស់វាតកតងនឹងវត្តមាននៃសម្ព័ន្ធភាពប្រដាប់អាវុធគឺជាអំពើដែលត្រូវបានប្រព្រឹត្តឡើងនៅក្នុងក្របខ័ណ្ឌនៃការវាយលុកជាទូទៅណានៃការវាយប្រហារជាទូទៅជាប្រព័ន្ធសម្ដៅប្រឆាំងនឹងជនស៊ីវិលនេះបើតាមក្រមព្រហ្មទណ្ឌបើជាទំនៀមទម្លាប់នៃច្បាប់អន្តរជាតិអនុវត្តតែចំពោះទំនាក់ទំនងនានារវាងរដ្ឋនិងរដ្ឋហើយមិនមែនអនុវត្តចំពោះអំពើរបស់បុគ្គលនោះឡើយហេតុដូច្នេះហើយបុគ្គលទាំងឡាយពុំត្រូវបានដាក់ឲ្យទទួលខុសត្រូវតាមច្បាប់អន្តរជាតិដែលជាគោលការណ៍ច្បាប់មួយដែលមិនទទួលស្គាល់នៅក្រោមធម្មនុញ្ញនរម្បែទេច្បាប់ទំនៀមទម្លាប់អន្តរជាតិមិនត្រូវបានអនុវត្តដោយផ្ទាល់នៅកម្ពុជាក្នុងចន្លោះឆ្នាំ1975និង79នោះទេដូច្នេះវាតម្រូវឲ្យមានការធ្វើច្បាប់ដើម្បីអនុវត្តហើយច្បាប់សម្រាប់អនុវត្តបែបនេះមិនមានទេនៅពេលនោះហេតុនេះការទទួលខុសត្រូវមិនអាចប្រមាលមើលទុកជាមុននៅកម្ពុជាក្នុងចន្លោះពីឆ្នាំ1975ទៅ79នោះទេហើយប្រសិនបើកម្ពុជាអាចអនុវត្តច្បាប់ទំនៀមទម្លាប់អន្តរជាតិដោយប្រព្រឹត្តផ្ទុយទៅនឹងមាត្រា12នៃវិធាន12នៃវិធានអវតក៏ដោយក៏អង្គជំនុំជម្រះត្រូវតែសម្រេចថាតើធៀបផ្សំនៃបទល្មើសនិងអំពើល្មើសនីមួយនីមួយនៃអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិនោះមានអ្វីខ្លះធៀបផ្សំនៃបទល្មើសនិងអំពើល្មើសនៃអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិមិនអាចបកស្រាយបានឬស្រាយបំភ្លឺបានទេដរាបណាមិនទាន់រកឃើញអត្ថិភាពរបស់ពួកវានោះដោយផ្អែកលើភស្តុតាងនៃធម្មនុញ្ញនរម្បែនិងច្បាប់ជាតិជាធរមានធាតុផ្សំនៃអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិតម្រូវឲ្យមានសម្ព័ន្ធភាពប្រដាប់អាវុធហេតុនេះលក្ខណៈច្បាប់នៅចន្លោះឆ្នាំ1975ទៅ1979មិនមានអ្វីច្បាស់លាស់នៅឡើយទេបានសេចក្តីថាបើពិនិត្យទៅលើអកតកម្មចន្លោះពីឆ្នាំ1975ដល់79ពុំឃើញមានធាតុផ្សំច្បាស់លាស់ឬអត្ថិភាពនៃបទអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ឡើយទោះបីជារកឃើញថាមានអំពើល្មើសមួយចំនួនរបស់បក្សកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យក៏ដោយក៏គេបានទាញហេតុផលថាការប្រព្រឹត្តឡើងក្នុងលក្ខណៈជាកម្មវិធីបោសសម្អាតក្នុងស្រុកមិនមែនជាលក្ខណៈជំលោះប្រដាប់អាវុធប្រឆាំងនឹងវៀតណាមឬថៃឡើយដូច្នេះការចោទប្រកាន់ដោយផ្អែកលើមូលដ្ឋានមាត្រា5នៃច្បាប់អវតកតាក់ទងនឹងបទអកតកម្មប្រឆាំងមនុស្សជាតិឃើញថាបានព្យាយាមទាញតម្លៃពិតប្រាកដរបស់ច្បាប់ឲ្យដើរថយក្រោយហើយប្រព្រឹត្តផ្ទុយនឹងគោលការណ៍ជាទូទៅនៃច្បាប់អន្តរជាតិរួមមានការហាមឃាត់ស្ដីពីការធ្វើច្បាប់ជំនុំជម្រះក្រោយអង្គហេតុបានស្ដីថាច្បាប់ពុំមានអនុភាព ាប្រតិសកម្មបានទេនេះជាអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំបាទលើកឡើងជូនទៅតុលាការដើម្បីតុលាការធ្វើការពិចារណាសូមអរគុណ
មកសូមអញ្ជើញសហប្រញ្ញាធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបនឹងចម្លើយរបស់សហមេធាវីកាពីជនជាប់ចោត
Very briefly, Your Honours. My learned friends across the world stated that the rape itself within S21 would have to be on a widespread or systematic basis. Indeed, there is only one episode of conduct that could amount to rape at S21, but I would take issue with that interpretation of the law, and I think it's now well founded within international jurisprudence that it's only the attack itself that needs to be widespread or systematic, not the individual act of rape of the accused, of the rape of the victim. And in fact, you can find that within the trial judgment where they, in fact, identify paragraphs 300 and 301 of the trial judgment. They explain very clearly that a widespread attack may refer either to the cumulative effect of a series of inhumane acts or the singular effect of an inhumane act of extraordinary magnitude. And then at paragraph 301, only the attack, not the underlying act, not the rape, must be widespread or systematic. Thank you, Mr. President.
កំណត់ថាអង្គើនីមួយៗនៅក្នុងបទល្មើសនោះតម្រូវឲ្យមានការលក្ខណៈទូលំទូលាយនិងលក្ខណៈប្រព័ន្ធនោះឡើយសូមអរគុណលោកស្រីចៅក្រម
សូមអញ្ជើញចៅក្រមរបាយការណ៍មានសំណួរទៅលើសហភាពញានិងសហមេធាវីជនជាប់ចោតបាទ
Thank you. I would have many questions, but since we don't have much time, maybe one of more general nature. We were being persuaded by the prosecution that notions of crimes for which the prosecution wants the accused to be autonomously convicted were known in international customary.
ដែលប៉ុន្តែដែលនៅក្នុងយោងទៅតាមច្បាប់ទំនៀមទម្លាប់អន្តរជាតិ
However I would be curious to know whether the prosecution may present that position as to the concrete definitions of crimes
ទាក់ទងទៅនឹងនិយមន័យជាក់លាក់នៃបទល្មើសនេះបានទេ
As international crimes
ក្នុងលក្ខណៈ specific of temporal jurisdiction of this court អន្តរជាតិទាក់ទងទៅនឹងយុត្តាធិការពេលវេលារបស់តុលាការនេះ
I think, Your Honour, the fact is we all accept, as I stated in our submissions, that the definition of these crimes have gradually crystallised. And I think it is not unreasonable for this court to look forward to the interpretation by Yugoslav war crimes crime that you want to find out which clearly their courts exercise judicial discretion in finding the elements of these offences. I'm not going to take issue at all on the basis of things that are gradually developing after the second court. But if I was to guide you in terms of seeking precedent for this court, of course, because it's taking forward to look for guidance or what the elements of these offences are by submission to you would be that those courts essentially were looking
ដែលតឡាការទៅលោកបានផលិតមកទៅលើវត្តសាហើយតាក់ទងទៅនឹងការសម្រេចរបស់តឡាការទាំងពីរនោះតាក់ទងទៅនឹងបទល្មើសដែលលោកស្រីចៅក្រមបានសួរនេះហើយជំររបស់ខ្ញុំគឺមិនមានដូចគ្នាប៉ុន្តែខ្ញុំបានជម្រាបជូនហើយគឺថាក្នុងមួយអំឡុងក្រោយពីសង្គ្រាមលោកទី2មកគឺគេបានធ្វើការវិវត្តនៅបទល្មើសនេះ
លោកថាព្រាងាមានចង់អីបន្ថែមទៀតបាទបើមានសូមអញ្ជើញបន្ថែមបាទ
Sorry your honor it's a habit from my jurisdiction that I stand as
I'm addressing judges ខ្ញុំបានលើកឲ្យខ្ញុំមិនអាចជួបបានខ្ញុំសូមការអនុញ្ញាតគួចចុះ
អញ្ចឹងសូមតឡាការប្រកាសសម្រាប់ហើយមក11យើងចូលវិញហើយសូមអញ្ជើញខាងមន្ត្រីពន្ធនាគារនាំជនចោតចូលកន្លែងសម្រាប់សិនបាទ
មកសូមអញ្ជើញកោកចោល